Compression is reducing the amount of information, but without, in a sense, losing any of it, trying to compress it and shorten it in such a way that you could, in principle, recover the full information that you started with. But in terms of transmitting it over a network, it's going to cost you less because you pay per bit or per byte or whatever. And if you can get the number of bytes down that you need to transmit to get something across the wire, then that benefits everybody, generally. You'd sometimes not compress because the following drawback happens. If you compress something, then you have to decompress it to get back the full story. That decompression takes time at the other end. Yeah, you have to get a computer on it saying, this was transmitted compressed because it saved BT bandwidth costs, but now I'm at this end and I want to see the real picture, I've got to uncompress it. So the nice thing about not compressing, if you don't mind the amount of data, is it's there at the other end and it's instantly processable. You compress data essentially by looking for repeated patterns and predictability. And I think if you take an example, shall we say, of a text file, something that repeats itself over and over again with stock buzz phrases used over and over and over again is going to be pretty compressible. If somebody writes a report that's got the phrase meaningful and relevant scenarios at this point in time going forward, then you take that out and it's been used 1,000 times and it drives you mad, and you make one copy of it at the top of the file, and that's maybe, I don't know, 50 characters, 50 bytes, and you say, I'm not gonna spend 50 bytes repeating that phrase every time in this report. I'm gonna compress it. Take one copy and I'll take a note of where it occurs in the file. It occurs at start positions 20, 800, 1500 and so on. And you can save a huge amount because those numbers take 3 or 4 bytes each, not 100 and odd bytes every time. Pictures are harder. Coming back to this idea that what makes things compressible is predictability, then if you think about a photograph, some photographs you could say do have predictable areas. You could take, shall we say, a photograph of, like on Microsoft Windows, there's a yellow desert island in the middle of a Pacific Ocean with one green tree. Well, that's easy because the Pacific is totally smooth. You've got thousands of blue pixels, you've got hundreds of yellow pixels for the desert island, a few hundred more for the tree. So you can compress it, not by sending every single pixel individually, but by saying, there's the sea, there's the colour blue, there's 1,000 of those, just replicate them. Similarly for the desert island and the tree. So that's what I mean by the element of predictability or common areas inside a picture. Now the average photo you take may be fairly simple if it's an indoor photo with flat surfaces, but you imagine taking a photograph, for example, of a sports car race or of an impressionist picture with blobs of painting all over the place, you know? That's much more random. And there isn't a pattern that you can pick up on to make it easily compressible. You basically have to take a deep breath and say, I'm going to have to transmit the whole thing because I can't see any patterns in here.
You were talking about these blue pixels. There may be 1,000 blue pixels,
yeah,
but the computer still has to know where to put every single one. So
yes,
how are we saving time?
You still have to transmit some minimal information as to where to start laying these pixels out on the screen. You say, start at such and such a position,
XY.
And XY. You know how wide the picture is. I just spew out 10,000 blue pixels and see how it fits in. What you don't have to say is, here is the spec of the blue pixel for position 1,000. Here is the same spec for the blue pixel at position 2001. You don't need to do that. You just send the spec once and say replicate it 400 or whatever times. Well, I'm making it simpler than it is. Perhaps one good example would be that JPEG compression. It's very common, has to be done to be able to get photographs down for size to uploading to sites like Picasa and Flickr. They're not going to be happy having every single one of your photos taking up 20 megabytes and being utterly perfect. They want to compress it down to kilobytes. And the problem is that many, particularly scenery and so on, is innately random enough looking that it's not easy to compress. So JPEG is an example of a compression that goes by the name of lossy. When we discussed earlier about compression in the text case, I put it to you that you could always recover the exact file because you had your buzz phrase, all the places it was replicated, nothing to stop you at the far end undoing all that and building it back exactly as it was with no loss. In a photographic case, you could try and do that, but you wouldn't get much compression because there's no predictability. So what JPEG does, it basically says, if you'll allow me to do some really clever things, I will try and get more compression out of it, but I may make the edges of your picture look a bit blurry and fuzzy as you magnify them. And it's doing it by all sorts of tricks about dividing the picture up into blocks and squares and saying, well, this is almost the same green. I'll use this as an approximation. It's never recoverable exactly the way you started, but you get a lot more compression that way if you don't mind an approximation. And for people in the human visual system looking at something, that can often be pretty good, particularly on a screen.
What are the compressing geniuses in their compression HQ were trying to do at the moment, or is it kind of, have they reached their limits? I mean, surely this has a limit.
There is a limit. This is something that's covered by a fascinating topic called information theory. Information theory will tell you what is called the entropy limit. Now, many viewers of this video will have heard of entropy and will freeze solid because they were taught it in physics and chemistry, right? As a computer scientist and an ex-chemist, let me tell you, learning about entropy is a lot easier from a computer science standpoint. No question about it. You can work out, for example, what's the minimum number of bits I need to transmit an piece of information in a lossless way. Let's concentrate on that. What's the minimum number of bits I can get away with? And I could...
Let's get you a piece of paper.
What happens if I send 101 and there are two errors in it, not just one? The errors just so happen that it turns...
We've got far too many machines here to fit inside this space.